privilege and the pleasure of serving as a guest host today on behalf of our creator and our regular and primary host, the Honorable Mayor C. Jack Ellis. Thanks so much for tuning in. Today we are discussing the Georgia Public Service Commission, and we're working today, we being myself and our guest today, Ms. Tia Lockhart, on the demystification of the Georgia Public Service Commission. That's what we're focused on today. A little backstory on how we got to this place and why we're focusing on that. Tia and I were cohort members of the Grist magazine cohort back in this past spring, and that consisted of she and I here in Macon, and one other young lady in Atlanta, and one other young lady in Augusta. Grist magazine, of course, is an online publication dedicated and committed to covering issues related to the best interests of the citizenry as it relates to consumerism, politics, and the environment in other areas. And so we were both honored and privileged to be a part of the Grist magazine cohort, which was coordinated and led by our illustrious and able leader, Ms. Lindsay Gilpin. Gotta give Lindsay some love and some shout outs and some props. Thank you so much, Lindsay Gilpin, with Grist magazine. Make sure you check out Grist magazine, gristmagazine.org. It's a very interesting publication and one that we think that you'll be pleased that you went to and learned more about. But basically, the reason we were charged with demystifying the Georgia Public Service Commission, which was created in 1879, to be exact, and who specialized here in Georgia in determining the utility rates, specifically in the areas of gas, telecommunications, and most commonly electricity. And, of course, they do that collectively with the primary electrical superpower in the state of Georgia, if you would, and that's Georgia Power, of course. So let's get into it, Tia. Tia, of course, also, this is my project, and the finalization of my project, which is the audiovisual and social media platform oriented project. Tia's, on the other hand, has co-produced with Lindsay a newsletter in partnership with the Make a Middle Georgia Black Pages. And it's available now, is that right, Tia? Or will be very soon as a three-part series?
Yes, sir.
And we'll let her explain that very briefly.
Yes, thank you so much, Ms. Clarence. So, my portion of the fellowship with Grist, I chose to do a newsletter. It's going to be a three-part newsletter. It's going to be going over pretty much kind of, it's going to be an expanded version of what we're doing here today. So, it's going to be talking about the history of the PSC and its significance, its role in our lives as consumers, and then the voting, the history of the lawsuit, and then also its impact on us health-wise, and just how energy connects to our health and why it's important for us to know and to demystify the PSC so we can have a better understanding and be empowered when it comes to decisions as relates to our electricity and our health.
Yes. Yeah, and the newsletter is very well done. I might ask for a few shout outs to you, Tia, on that. I'm very so proud of you, so happy for you. And thank you to Alex Habersham, the owner and founder of the Macon Middle Georgia Black Pages here in Macon, for thinking it not robbery and supporting the project and seeing why it's important that voters know about the Public Service Commission and ways in which they can directly engage it and determine, most of all, what their rates are like every time they get an electrical bill each month. That's one of the main reasons that we're doing this project. It's also an empowerment piece. In fact, her newsletter is entitled Power to the People. And we'll get back to that near the end of this segment and talk a little bit about that very soon. But we'll get off now to the Public Service Commission dynamics. Let's talk a little bit about the dynamics, Tia. They're elected, of course, statewide. And it's five members of the statewide elected board. And they come from districts. So if you want to expound on that, you can expound on that.
Yes, absolutely. Thank you, Mr. Clarence. So there are five districts statewide for Georgia. Each of the commissioners has to represent the district in which they live in that district, the votes are not only coming from that district. So if you live in, let's say, District 5, everyone in the state of Georgia is going to vote for your district commissioner. And so with that, we see a lot of, what's the word? So it can be a bit daunting when you realize that your vote is not being impacted in the way that it should be. So it waters down that vote. And so that's one of the things we're going to get into when we talk about the lawsuit. But those members, each of those members right now are currently Republican. 4 out of the 5 commissioners that we see right now were initially appointed by governors. And then were elected. Some of them have not gone through their initial election. Some of them have been elected as incumbents. But again, they were initially appointed 4 out of 5 by governors. So when we talk about having our votes matter and understanding the significance of what it means to vote for elected officials, but having those officials appointed, that's something that is a very polarizing dynamic. And we have to, you know, be able to educate ourselves and understand why things like that shouldn't be happening.
To a degree, it's almost like you're voting, but you're not being adequately represented in that instance in this system of attack by any degree. Disclaimer here: this is simply information, public information that we've been charged with providing, and also conveying to the public. Because we'll talk a little bit about where we are with that as it relates to the public actually knowing. I was also privileged to create a survey that we've done and that we took, and we'll share some of the findings in that survey in just a little bit. And we're going to double back and expound a little bit more on the impact of what is believed to be or perceived to be by some as improper representation or lack of adequate representation, since they are elected statewide, but come from districts. A little bit later, as we talk about the lawsuit that was brought against them in recent years. The Voting Rights Act lawsuit that was brought against them in recent years. But right now, we'll stick with what we're talking about as it relates to the dynamics. So they preside over the way the electrical rates are determined, and basically, is in layman's terms, Georgia Power in turn they pitch the Public Service Commission more or less what they believe the rates should be. And then the Public Service Commission then, in turn, looks at that, and then they make recommendations or they make suggestions regarding what Georgia Power gives them initially to look at and to review. And then collectively, if I got this right to you, they sort of come up with a place that they can both live with and that they think will work for both of them, and that's how we get our bill every month.
Absolutely. So we see the PSC as a regulatory body over Georgia Power, but you also see it because Georgia Power is a for-profit company that they're, you know, what they're looking for is to increase profits for them. So, yes, they negotiate and go back and forth. There used to be a Consumers Utility Council that was defunded back in 2009. Now, that utility council was an advocate for ratepayers being the people. So anyone who is directly paying rates to Georgia Power, that utility council would have been there to fight for you, for us, on our behalf, in the same way that Georgia Power is fighting for itself on its behalf. And so one of the things that really we want to discuss as far as how this relationship and the outcome impacts us. So when we see the PSC and you see representation that may or may not be representative of you, your district, your values, and what you want from your commissioner, we see that impacted on our daily bills. We see that impacted in our infrastructure, energy infrastructure. So are we using clean energy? Are we using fossil fuels, things of that nature? Are we energy efficient in our homes? Mm-hmm. So things like that, that is what impacts us, because our energy efficiency, if your house is inadequately energy efficient, you're going to be paying more in the results of the PSC's regulatory practices, how that impacts us, not just as it relates to Georgia Power, but like our energy bills, our monthly bills, our household, you know, all of those things play out.
Absolutely. The bottom line is, an already challenging economy, we need to be as empowered economically as we can, as often as we can. So it's important that people know what they're being charged and how they're being charged every month in those electrical bills. Thank you, Tia. Let's get into the lawsuit. So voting rights, a group out of Atlanta in recent years got together and decided that the way that they are elected is a violation of the Voting Rights Act. Talk a little bit about that real fast and where we are currently with that.
Okay, yes, absolutely. So back in 2020, there were a group of voters in Atlanta, in the metro Atlanta area, that alleged that the way the PSC commissioners are elected diminishes Black votes because they aren't representative of the individual districts. So this, again, is that watering down of the vote. Because the officials are elected statewide, not just in those individual districts. So what we have seen since the lawsuit was filed, that a federal court found that the election methods of the PSC did violate the Voting Rights Act of 1965. However, that was overturned by an appeals court. And then what we saw this past summer from the Supreme Court of the United States was that they declined to take up the case, to even listen to the case again. So right now, we are dealing with, like you all know, an election, a very critical presidential election that's coming up. And when we see the impact that our elected officials have when they are making appointments into certain positions, we understand that impact is going to affect us. It's going to be a trickle-down effect. So there haven't been any PSC elections since 2020 when the initial lawsuit was filed. Mm-hmm. There are some other lawsuits in the works, and that's pretty much the summary of what's going on with the vote. So we're seeing Black people, people of color, minority people trying to fight for their right to use their votes and express it in a way that is going to be impactful.
Yeah, and it's important that we bear in mind that this is an extension of a fight that communities of color, specifically the Black community, has been in political struggle that we've been in for for quite some time. And you think at some point it would go away, but it always seems to rear its ugly head at some point through something.
Absolutely. So when we talk about systemic issues, that's what we're looking at. Because a lot of times we want to say we don't realize those trickle-down effects. So even, for instance, having appointed commissioners on the PSC where you didn't initially have your own choice to choose which commissioner would be someone who would do what's in your best interest for your community in that space, and now they're being appointed, and now everybody else in the state has that election and can choose for you what's best for you and your community. So that is not something that's new to Black people. You know, we had poll taxes, we see voter suppression in so many ways, even recently with, you know, people being purged out of the registration for voters. So there is a lot of ways that ballot boxes in Oregon and Washington State. So when we understand the power of our voice, that our vote is our voice, we really have to start paying attention and being civically engaged and understanding how we are connected to all of these plans and policies that are going into place because other people are benefiting. And if we as a community, as people in this society who want to see equity, equitable housing, equitable pricing, things like that, then we have to become engaged in that process.
Absolutely, well said. Yeah, so now the bottom line here is how do we save money? How do we impact, directly impact what we get billed and how we get charged every month with the public service, Georgia Public Service Commission, working in tandem with Georgia Power. So we're going to try to provide that to you here as we get ready to close out here in just a little bit. You know, education is key. We think and we believe, and we have resources. We have excellent resources in the form of GRIS stories. There are numerous stories on the Georgia Public Service Commission at GRIS.org. Let's not forget about that. Tia's newsletter was a tremendous resource. It was co-produced by Gamers Lindsay Gilpin with GRIS.org. And it's available again very soon in the very near future through the Macon Middle Georgia Black Pages online, as well as Public Service Commission itself. In fact, psc.ga.gov is their website. I encourage you, and we encourage you to go there and learn more about who they are, according to them. And you can also attend meetings and stay current. And one of the ways in which you can do that is by making sure that if you get a chance to fill out the survey that I was privileged to create. This is an actual survey that I produced. And on this survey, we asked numerous questions to citizens. And some of the most interesting things that came out of that was about 60% of the people Tia said that they never heard of the PSC. 100% said that they wanted to learn more about it. And about 75% said they wanted to get involved in a local PSC-related group or organization. And so that's one of the goals that we are working towards with this as well, is to create mechanisms and actual groups or organizations by which people can actually directly engage the PSC if they don't want to do it individually at meetings and things like that, or they can do it indirectly as a collective or as a group with organizations and groups. And another one of those groups is a lobbyist group, and that is Georgia Conservation Voters. Georgia Conservation Voters, and they can be reached or see more at gcvoters.org, gcvoters.org. And they're a lobbyist group that is real engaged and on point with as it relates to the Georgia Public Service Commission. As we continue, Tia, talk a little bit then about what the hopes are for the newsletter and how people can access that very, very soon.
Okay, yes, sir. So, the newsletter, the goal is to educate and to empower, and it's also a call to action. Mm-hmm. So we want to inform you of, you know, who the PSC is, the history of the PSC, some of the choices that they have made, the decisions that they make that affect your lives on a daily basis, and then also to give you some education on what we the lawsuit, what we're doing in that regards with the the violation of the Voting Rights Act of 1965. So education on that and understanding how that still relates today, and even with the health and the infrastructure component, making that connection to energy and health, understanding things like if your air ventilation isn't good, your air quality in your home isn't going to be good. So we see lots of instances of like asthma and things like that, that can not only be attributed to the environment in our outside, but also our inside environment in our home. So if we don't have up-to-date electrical, stove, microwave, things like that, if those things are out of date, if you have to buy a pilot light on your gas stove, you know, that can be causing health issues as well. So there are a lot of things that we have to consider to be educated on as, you know, just people in this space living, because a lot of times things are not looked at or they're glossed over, and they are directly impacting our quality of life. So the newsletter is aimed to just get us looking at the PSC energy and health in a different way. And then again, also calling us action. So getting involved, giving us some resources. So when we talk about our bills being high, we have sources like the EOC who provides provide sources for like energy bills, gas bills, and then you also have the Georgia Power itself, who does have some energy assistance programs as well. So they're, you know, combating some of the rate hikes that they're so we're just trying to educate everybody in all aspects, because the more informed we are, the more empowered we are, and the more better able we are to affect change in a positive way, where we're not feeling so defeated because, you know, our votes, our voice doesn't matter, or people are going to let, you know, whatever our thought process may be when it comes to voting, and a lot of us not using our vote. This is just to help us understand that our vote, your voice does matter. It is important, and you do need to vote. Please vote. Go out and vote by November 5th. But then also, just not on presidential elections, but staying active and engaged and involved throughout the year. So when we talk about watchdog groups, it's not just something for once a year, but we're meeting, wanting to meet consistently and develop, get the real capacity and have people really engaged and active and advocate for themselves. So
Absolutely. Well said, Tia. Your direct contact information, your email address where the public can reach you directly, I'm going to give mine as well.
Okay, yes, absolutely. So I can be reached by email at TIANL2287@gmail.com. Again, that's TIAN like Nancy, L like Larry, 2287@gmail.com. I'm also available. I have a Facebook page, Tia Lockhart, Instagram, Tia Lockhart as well. And then you can reach me directly. Phone number 478-335-2187. I'm always available.
And the newsletter is going to be what's the website?
The newsletter is going to be on Macon Middle Georgia Black Pages. It'll be on the website for Macon Middle Georgia Black Pages, and the website is
Okay, we'll come back to you for that as she finds it. I'm going to give the public my contact information if they want to follow up with me as it relates to anything that we've been talking about today around the Georgia Public Service Commission. My email address is thomasjr63@gmail.com, thomasjr63@gmail.com. You can also direct message me on my Facebook page, Clarence Woodall Thomas Jr., or you can hit me up on Instagram as well. Tia, you got the website for Macon Middle Georgia Black Pages?
Yes.
Where the newsletter will be soon?
Yes, it will be on MaconBlackPages.com. So we have the app. We also have the website. You will be able to get it on the news and views section of the website. So once it is it's gone to print, I'll send some updates. But we'll also have this attached as well, so that way you all be able to check out the newsletter as well as the video as well, some additional
things. So. Gotcha. Yeah. As we close out, I did want to just reiterate and clarify and do a little mini disclaimer once again that this is not an attack on the Georgia Public Service Commission or Georgia Power. We know that they have their roles and their functions. We respect that. This is simply an empowerment platform and an empowerment piece designed for people to be educated concerning how they receive the rates that they get every month on their electrical bills, and how we might, as consumers and as the public taxpayers of Georgia, impact those what we receive every month in our bill, and simply that and nothing more and nothing less. But we'd be remiss if we did not give you the backstory behind the PSC and also let you know who they are, how they're elected, and how they come to be when they are elected. And we also wanted to make sure that we pointed people to their side of the story, who they are, and what their function is. And again, that's psc.ga.gov. That's their website. And of course, if you desire to become a part of a group that is designed to engage them directly on behalf of the citizens and yourself, then you can reach out to the Georgia Conservation Voters at www.gcvoters.org. as we've got about 2 minutes left here in this segment, Tia, let's also talk a little bit as well about some of the other things that you are involved in as we close out, and I'll do the same so that people can know more about who we are and some of the other things that we're involved in the community.
Absolutely. So just very quickly, I am an AmeriCorps service member. I'm currently working with the Central Georgia Coalition for Black Businesses. We are doing some work with community engagement. I'm a community engagement facilitator. And ultimately, the goal is a holistic view. I'm working through business, community, and government, making those connections with our community stronger, understanding Black consumerism, understanding Black business, and how it connects and relates, how we need to all be unified, have one main goal and purpose. And so that's the work I'm doing. I'm also doing some work with some neighborhood associations. I've done a little bit of work with Ms. Judy Gordon, who's over at Neighborhood Watch. And I'm really just a community advocate. So look to me for, you know, that's what, if you see me, say hi. I'm out in the community working and trying to connect people to resources and empower people.
You're doing a fantastic job too, Tia, and she's extremely passionate about what she does and really into what she does. And thank you so much for that. On the other hand, you probably see me often as the supervisor of Frank Johnson Recreation Center on behalf of Macon-Bibb County Department of Parks and Recreation. That's what I do daily and full time for Macon-Bibb County government. But when I'm not there doing that, I'm also writing for somebody somewhere, whether it be the Little Georgia Informer newspaper, Macon Magazine, and most recently the Macon Metro, and periodically for Georgia Magazine, the Georgia Train Magazine as well. And so that's my other gift and passion, and that's what I do when I'm away on a professional capacity. But I'm also, of course, in the community trying to mentor youth and work with youth as a volunteer through organizations like Mahogany Principle, working as well to increase people's cultural and educational awareness through organizations like Kwanzaa Cultural Access Center, which I'm also a proud member of as well.
It's a children's book, but it's for everyone. Yes. Anyone can learn the lessons in that book. It is quite phenomenal.
Yes. And it's called My Little Life. And it was actually born out of a 2007 trip with the Honorable Mayor C. Jack Ellis, sister city trip to Elmina, Ghana, West Africa, back in 2007. And I wanted to merge that experience between Africa and here, and the creation of the children's book is what I was inspired to do, and I'm very, very grateful to have done it. So we're going to thank you once again for tuning in to this edition of the Middle Georgia Spotlight. Thank you so much again, Mayor Ellis, for letting us sit in. Thank you, Ron, for letting me borrow the seat that you borrow sometimes from Mayor Ellis. And thank you, Mr. Charles Watt, the fantastic, amazing producer and director of the Middle Georgia Spotlight. Thanks again for tuning in. We'll see you next time. We're privileged to be in these seats.
Thank you.